I hear the rolling thunder.
I've been getting paid $1,000 a month, if not more, just from this app on my phone. And I don't know if
thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. If I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal king. And I'm sure that He'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. Places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. while I stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
Churches around us. God, I pray that you continue to move through every church in this community. God, God, as you stand before us every Sunday and every Wednesday we meet, Lord, we realize that we couldn't do it without you. God, you're all we need tonight. Lord, we want to meet with you tonight. We want your spirit to fill this place tonight. God, speak to our hearts tonight. Open our eyes. Open our hearts, God, to you. Receive your word tonight, that we might go out of this place tonight rejoicing that we've been with the Lord tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
tonight has drifted away. My feet are planted on higher ground, and glory to God, I'm homeward bound. He set me free, yes, He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. Glory to God, He set me free. Goodbye to sin and things that confound. Not of the world shall turn me around. Daily I'm working, I'm praying too. Glory to God, I'm going through. He set me free. He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. Glory to God, He set me free.
Thank you, Jesus. Man, you may be seated. Sister Shanda's going to come up and sing.
This is Robert's fault.
You ready?
It's okay if it's hard to believe.
That's beautiful. Amen. We're going to ask you to stand and worship with us.
Thank you. to us. There's no love like His, Lord.
Oh, glorious day, oh, glorious day.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for everything you brought us today, Lord. We thank you for just covering this day with your hand, Lord. We just continue to ask you to just be with us right now while we're doing this revival, Lord. We thank you for being with us during this worship, Lord. And we pray that these words reach people's hearts, Lord. Because we know it's not the words we're speaking, Lord, but it's all from you. It doesn't matter who's speaking or what's all coming from you. We thank you for that, Lord. Continue to be with us through this time, Lord. And once again, we just pray that they reach minds and hearts, Lord. And Lord, if for the ones that You're so merciful, Lord. You're so good to us. You're so
thank you.
We just can't thank you enough for what you do, Lord.
Amen.
We just love and praise you in your precious name.
Amen.
Sometimes I struggle with my scripture, change my mind. I don't know how y'all do. The Lord changes my mind.
Yeah.
But when I got, Brother Fred and I were both sick the day of the breakfast. But so I asked Brother Mike, I said, what's this theme? What scripture did you use? And so he told me it was Acts 4:33. And so that is going to be my, it resonated with me. And
Amen.
I think it will y'all too. Acts 4:33. I'll wait till y'all get there. I had mine marked. Y'all stand. Thank you for the word of the Lord. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all.
Amen.
Let's bow. Dear Lord, we just humbly come before you today. We're just giving you all the praise and the glory that you so deserve. And we're just thankful, dear Lord, for your grace, your great grace,
Amen.
Which we so undeserve, but we're so thankful for it. We're thankful for the mercy that goes right along with it. It's you holding back the things, the punishment that we so deserve, and we're thankful for it. We just ask that you join in here tonight, dear Lord, with your sweet spirit. You already have. And we're thankful for each one that's represented here. And we just ask that you touch our hearts and change lives tonight. Dear Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all may be seated. And I think where I'm wanting to go with this, lots of times I preach at a little church. I mean, I was raised over at Roswell Chapel, and the Lord called me, like 2006, to ministry. You know, he had to wait till I went through those wild years, you know, and he had to wait till I got ready, honestly, is what it was, and so he could use me. And I'm so thankful that, you know, we got to the point that we could come together. And so I preach at a little church in Southern Illinois, two Sundays a month, and it's a little Cumberland Presbyterian church, and we're all one church, we know that. But it's got about generally about 6 to 8 people there, so I'm like in a big crowd tonight, and I'm excited. But the Lord is good. He has blessed me and blessed all of us, I know. And I just want to talk a little bit about what is grace, because God has extended so much grace to me in my life. All of us, he has. I mean, we just have such a loving God. We have a God that loves us when we're in love with us. And I'm very thankful for that. And so I asked the question. I was trying to think of something I could bring to the table. I mean, stuff we already know, but isn't that sort of what we do? We rehash the word in the Bible all the time in different ways, and we learn and grow from it all. So what is grace? Grace is undeserved, unworked for favor from God to mankind.
Amen.
It includes grace, of course, love, mercy, again, for the mercy, for we should be punished, but because of Jesus, and that Jesus wanted to die on the cross for our sins, we are extended that mercy.
Amen.
And all we have to do is accept it. And that always is my mother thought she was saved her whole life until she was maybe in her 60s, I can't remember. And then she realized that she had never really talked to the Lord. She had never given him her heart. She had visited her when her and my daddy got married. They visited my grandfather, who was a pastor, and they talked a little bit about it. And my daddy said, well, you're saved then. You're saved, you know. But she never really made a commitment to the Lord. I don't think she really understood, you know, what she was doing. And so she was at a revival, and she said, I don't know how I got to the altar. She said, I don't remember. She said, I just know that it was the Holy Spirit. And so she got up there, and she said, I want to be saved. And so it's like a big deal with me. You know, God extended his grace with her and others in our family. My brother as well, you know, had realized he wasn't saved. My sister, my younger sister, they were saved this year, both of them. I believe it this year, and I believe it was. And we're so thankful for that. So that is like a really big thing with me. lost souls. You know, my husband wasn't saved until 3 weeks before he passed away, and my son was about 25 years old. And so, before you leave here tonight, that needs to be your number one focus. And you just know, you talk to the Lord, and you make sure that you and Him have had that one-on-one where you have told Him that you're His and He's yours, and that He can take your life. I hate to tell you, but I got sort of kind of down and out one time during that process before the Lord called me to preach. And, you know, sometimes it involves money. Sometimes it involves, you know, some of the hardships that we have. You know, just things that go on in our lives, whether it's the work or whatever. But, you know, sometimes we get down and out. And, you know, we get to the point sometimes we just want to give up. And so we can't do that. And that is my number, probably 1A thing tonight, is that you can never give up. And it doesn't matter what point that you get to in your life, because I remember I was laying down on the couch, and I was like, I had finally reached the point. I said, I'm done. I just don't think I can make another day. And you know, that's a hard place to be, especially when you got a mom and daddy that's, you know, good role models. I was raised in a Christian home. You know, I knew better than to get to a point like that. You know, but I did. And so, praise God for Christian TV. And I heard someone on there saying, hey, you know, you out there, that she said, you never give up. And so I was walking out of the living room, but then she goes, no, you that's living in the living room. And I said, and I was like, that's for me. So anyway, so she said, don't you ever give up. And so that's what I want to tell you. There might be one person here, but not just one. I mean, I hope there's not any. But if there's one to where you're to the point sometimes where you're just ready to give up, never give up. Because what I learned was that the Lord Jesus, he'll walk with you during your walk, you know, in the darkness and in the valleys. And that there is light at the end of the tunnels. And so I just had to start envisioning that. And it was a beautiful journey. I mean, now that I look back, it was hard. But I was strengthened from the Lord. Because what I told him was, I said, Lord, you know, my life's a mess. My life is just a mess. You take it. You take it and you do what you want to do. And that was the turning point in my life. And I'm so thankful for that. And it was a journey. But the Lord strengthened me through it because I knew he was walking and I would envision. I could see myself walking through the tunnel and there was light. And it was getting closer and closer. And I was so thankful because I knew that one day I was going to get, you know, I was going to be in the light. And
amen.
So I kept walking, and I remember one day came home from work, and I said, I'm on the edge. I am so close to the light. I am so close. And so it was a journey, you know, and then all of a sudden I realized that I was in the light, y'all. I had made it. The Lord had walked with me through the journey, and I was never going to be the same anymore because of God's great grace. So I think I just want to tell you tonight what I tell my little church in Illinois. I'm like, y'all, there's more. You know, there's just more that God wants us to have in our lives. He wants us to have better lives. He wants us to have quality lives. And if you're living any kind of a substandard life, I'm not saying you might not be sick, but you should have your heart every morning when you wake up, you just praise God that you woke up and every day. And we just have to know that we have to depend on him, I mean, for everything. And, you know, I've talked to some people and they'll, like, be depressed, you know, and I'm like, you know, for a season, for a moment, it's okay to be depressed. I guess we all have those days, like on a cloudy day, where, you know, you might be down and out. But beyond that, we have a God who extends great grace. And so we have to rise above that only with his help. When we start trying to do things on our own, you know, pick ourselves up by our bootstraps, you know, it's not going to last very long. But when you get God involved, and you ask him to help you, I mean, he's going to. And so I just had a few little points that I wanted to talk about because I never stick to my notes. But anyways, there's about four things that I wanted to talk about that would be ways that we can plunge into being closer to God so that he can just envelop us with his grace and his love and his mercy and his kindness. And one of them is so simple. The first one, prayer. But you know, some people don't pray a lot. They don't want to bother God. You know, I've got a family member and he told me one time, he said, no, I only take the important things to God. Just the ones that, you know, I really, really need help with. And I said, no, our God, he wants to be involved in every detail of our life. And so you take everything to him. He knows the number of hairs on your head. So he's like really clued in to what our needs are and our thoughts and everything. So, prayer. And people say, I think sometimes people don't really know how to pray. Because I didn't really. You know, people say, well, pray. But really and truly, it's like you're talking to your best friend. You're telling them about, you're thanking them. Number one, thank you, Lord, Thank you for keeping me safe. Thank you for watching over and caring for me. Thank you for my family.
Yeah.
Just thank him, number one. And then you're going to tell him about your needs and your wants, you know.
Yes.
And tell him that you really want him to start planning, because that you know that he's got a plan for your life, right?
Yeah.
And you're like, some of you are here, well, like, I'm older, so I don't think he does. But yes, he does.
Yeah, right.
My daddy, even in his later years, I mean, my daddy lived to be almost 90, and he had a ministry at the courthouse with the community service workers, with the, you know, the gentlemen that were from the jail, and he loved them, and he told them about Jesus, and he gave them bubble gum, but it wasn't just bubble gum. He was extending love and God's grace to them, and so. We can always, always make a difference in people's life. We can, you know, we can pray. We can ask God to put people in our path. He does that for us sometimes, you know. He'll have somebody cross your path so that you can give them a word. Maybe a word of encouragement. Maybe to tell them about Jesus. You know, at first that was kind of hard for me. I don't know about y'all. You know, but you see somebody at the dollar store, at Walmart, something like that, and you're like, You get this feeling, you know, the Lord will give you that feeling, that unction, as Brother Fred calls it, unction, or a burden, you know, and it's like, you know, he wants you to say something to him.
Yeah.
And you're like, I don't really want him to hear, you know, but then you're like, but you know what, I don't want to disappoint the Lord. And so you say something like, hey, you know, you're doing okay. And generally, when people are not doing okay, they're going to let you know. You know, they're going to share it with you. Well, you know, I'm having a hard time. We're having a hard time as a family. Pray for my son. Pray for my daughter. And I say, I surely will. And I say, well, let me ask you this. Do you have a church home? It's gotten really easy for me to say that now. And sometimes they do, and sometimes they don't. And so I think us as God's children, we're supposed to be telling people about Jesus the best way we can.
Amen.
And so then you tell them about churches in the area or wherever it is that you are. You know, or find a church home, pray about it. Ask God to get you to the right church. Church where you're going to feel like you're at home.
Amen.
And then I have just really not that recently, but I mean, yeah, pretty recently, I guess you'd say. I will pray. If I feel like that somebody needs prayer in the DG or in the Walmart or wherever it is, you know, it's not me thinking, it's the Lord putting, you know, his spirit on me to pray for them. So I will pray for them. So y'all, we are the light of the world. So wherever it is that we are, we have to extend that mercy to these people and just pray for them right there. Just put your hand on them and pray and, you know, ask God to bless them and help them and strengthen them. I didn't do it one time. He gave me an opportunity. It was right before he called me to ministry. And there was a woman that called my office, and she was telling me about the problem she was having with her daughter and all. And I was thinking, you know, I just wondered, did they have a church home? Were they in church? But I didn't say it. I didn't say it, and the Lord was dealing with me. And so when I let her hang up, and y'all, there is nothing more disappointing than disappointing God and knowing that he was giving you an opportunity to say something to somebody. And you may not change the life right then, but you are planting a seed. And that's what we have to do as Christians, you know. So anyway, I'm like, Lord, I am so sorry that I didn't say something to her. I'm really sorry. But I said, if you give me another opportunity with her, I'll say something.
Yeah.
And 5 minutes later, that lady called back. And she was going to ask me some other question. And I'm like, I'm on it. So I said, and so I just was talking to her. And, you know, I never try to be pushy or too bold. I don't want to, because Jesus was easy. You know, he was talking with people. I mean, he just knew how to talk to people. And he knew how to extend love. And so I said to her, you know what? I said, what helps me and my family a lot? And I said, we go to church. And I said, do you have a church home? And she didn't. And so we started talking about different opportunities. And I said, you're going to find that that's going to help you, because you're going to be around people that love you. And so, anyway, I don't know. I don't even know the lady's name. I don't know what happened. But I know that I obeyed the Lord and that I, you know, said something to her. But not only that, generally what I do after that is I pray for the people. And he's done that in my life. I bet he's done that in all y'all's lives too. He's put people in your path. And, you know, it gives you an opportunity to pray for them or, you know, to God will give you a burden. And he won't let up. And I'm thankful for that. A few other things we can pray about, of course, all the details and everything going on in your life, but, you know, and the will, you know, God's will for your life, for sure. You want to know what that is, but I used to make my own decisions. You know, when I did, I remember one time having, I put in applications everywhere. I had 3 job interviews. And did I pray? No, I didn't. I was young, and I don't know. I just didn't, you know, my daddy was praying. But anyways, I didn't pray. And I chose the job that I thought I wanted. You know, that was just the flesh making a decision. And so, anyway, I mean, it turned out okay. But I wonder, you know, I think back about that. And, you know, God is gracious. And he made everything work okay because I'm up here today. And I wouldn't change that for anything, y'all. The other thing, of course, is you can pray for your children, like your grandchildren, nieces and nephews and all. Pray for their, something I really started learning was pray for their spouse. You know, that he's preparing the spouse that he has ordained for them. And I never really knew to do that when my son was little, but I read it as he got older and I started praying. And but I don't just leave it at that. I'm like, Lord, I want the lady that you bring him, I want her to love my son. And I want him to love them. And I want that family to love me and my husband. And I want us to love them. I mean, I covered all bases.
Amen.
And so that's exactly what we got. I'm not saying that occasionally people don't, you know, have a little disagreement about something, but we love. And that's the important thing. And, of course, praying for... you know, for your family, for salvation. I will give you an example of how God really listens to it. Sometimes you have to put your army boots on and you have to just like go to war, fighting for your family. And my son was not saved and my husband wasn't saved. But at that time, I was worried about my son because he was on the road all the time. And it just was a really burden on me that my son wasn't a Christian. And so I went to the church where he and his, they were engaged at the time. They were going to this church. And so I went to that church parking lot, and I prayed over that church as good as I knew how. And I prayed that the Lord would send his angels to do battle over that and break any strongholds or anything that was trying to take over my son. And I want you to know that 2 weeks later, after I got serious with God and really called on him, 2 weeks later, my son, he accepted the Lord. He accepted the Lord. The other thing is, something I've just, I don't, everything I'm telling y'all today, I don't really do like I should, but I'm working on that, okay? I'm working on my prayer life. I'm working on reading the Bible. You know, my daddy and my uncle Penny Clapp and Jacksonville Clapp, they all knew the Bible, the history and all that. And something about me, I didn't really like the history. In church, I get so sleepy. And so that's something now that I'm trying to learn because I wasn't paying attention, you know, when I was a kid. So, reading the Bible is really important and because it is the living word.
Amen.
You know, in Genesis, it talks about how God created everything with his words, with the breath of his words. And so we know that we also were created in his image and that there's also power in our words. And when we read the Bible, not only reading the Bible, but there's power. We can build people up or we can tear people down And our roles as Christians, you encourage people. You tell them about Jesus. But also, I've heard a gentleman give a testimony, and he was talking about reading the word aloud. He was a new Christian, and that somebody told him there was power in the word because it was living. He said, you know, you read the word out loud, and he was sick. He was really sick. He was in the World War II, and he was in a hospital and not expected to get well. And what he did, he asked the orderly, he said, how do you give the medicine every day? And the gentleman said, young man said, well, we give it 3 times a day, medicine, you know, for your sickness after meals. And so this gentleman, World War II veteran, he said he started doing that. He started reading the word out loud every day, 3 times a day after his meals. And he had, there was some kind of an illness that you get overseas, and I forgot what it is, but there was no healing of it. But the Lord healed him. Amen. Because of the power of the word, because of God's great grace.
Amen.
And y'all, we just, I know I get sidetracked a lot, but if anything about your life, when you walked into here tonight, if there is a burden on you, if there is a mistake that you made in the past that haunts you a little bit, you know, you have to know that God's great grace gives forgiveness. All you have to do is ask. And we are not supposed to be carrying that weight around. You know, it could be a mistake that you made, you know, last week. It could be a mistake that you made, you know, 30 years ago or whatever. But I'm just saying that the Lord, that's not a life that God is in control of your life. You're allowing Satan to get in there and convict you of things that you've done. But once you ask forgiveness, you ask the Lord, and he's going to forget it. So you might as well forget it. And so that's what I've been trying to tell my little church, y'all. There's more. There is just more to our lives as long as God is in control. I mean, we don't need to wake up. We don't need to be depressed. And with our sickness, we turn it over to the Lord. I don't understand how sometimes he heals and sometimes he doesn't. But he's God, and he knows what he's doing. But I'm so thankful. There's another thing. We have to have the passion that Jesus had. You know, Jesus healed everybody that wanted to be healed. He did in the Bible. Wasn't that beautiful? You know, you don't say that there was not one person that he said, nah, I'm tired. Not today. He didn't do that. And so we can go before him all the time. But the passion that he had is what we should try to mimic, that, you know, have that kind of passion. And I didn't used to have it. I'm just going to tell you right now, I used to have a selfish heart, and I didn't do for people. I didn't care for people like I should have. And I can remember the day that I recognized that was I saw some people that maybe were a little out of place looking, you know, in a church. And I thought something about that. I'm like, they don't seem like they really fit in here. And I'm so sorry that I thought that, but I'm giving y'all this as that God healed me from that. And I said, Lord, something's wrong. Something's wrong. I shouldn't be feeling like that. I don't like that about my heart. And I said, I want to have the love and compassion of Jesus. And I want to see people through Jesus' eyes.
Amen.
And y'all, after that, I have got the softest heart. And I'm so thankful for that, because I did not like me. And I'm sure that, you know, other people didn't like me either. But now I want to help people, and I pray for people, and I want people to have their best lives. I know we all do, but I mean, I'm telling you, you gotta depend on God to help you out. The next thing is the last thing is pretty much proclamation. That we got to tell people about Jesus. Because if we're just sharing in here about Jesus, the people out there is not going to hear about it. So we have to be sure that when we get an opportunity, we just got to tell them. And I've heard other people say that, that Christians, there's something that people see, they feel in Christians, and they want it. They don't know what it is, but they want it. It's Jesus. And so that's what we want to do. We want them to see that light in us, and we want them to say, hey, what is it about you? And then you can say, well, you know what? It's got to be Jesus. I'm not perfect, but you know what? I got Jesus right here.
Amen.
So we got to proclaim that. And I was going to give you a couple, or I was going to give you an example. This, I went to the chiropractor this last week, and I was waiting to pay, and there was a gentleman. I don't know how old he was, maybe William or Mike, I don't know, around y'all's age. And he was paying, and I was just standing there listening. He was carrying on a conversation with a lady at the desk, and she was saying she was glad he's better. You know, that she said, we were really praying for you. And of course, I didn't know him, and he said, I saw Jesus. And of course, I was in on it then. I'm like, you saw Jesus? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, did he say anything? And he said, no. He said, what it was, he had had a brain aneurysm, and he was not expected to make it. And I don't know who it was, so I don't mean to be talking about people, but it's only a beautiful story, so I think I can share that. And so he said he didn't die, but Jesus came to him, or he went to Jesus. And you know, I said, did he say anything? He said, no. He said he was writing in the dirt. And he said he likes to write in the dirt. And I thought, man, that is... He was so close to Jesus that he knew that. He knew that Jesus just likes to write in the dirt. And so then he said, and he put his arm around. He said he had his robe on. I thought, what did I ask him to do the robe look like? But I don't know. But anyway, and then he said, and he put his arm around me. And I'm like, oh, wow. But I said, but he didn't say anything? He said, no. He said, he touched me. And I said, so I wanted to share that with you all because that man received great grace.
Yes.
And he's telling people about it. He just wanted her to know, I saw Jesus. And, you know, and I heard, and I don't know who else was in there, but I'm praying for the gentleman. You know, he looked fine. You know, I was there, he was there. He was walking, but God's touched his life. He's got something for him to do.
Yes.
So, you see what an influence that gentleman had on me? I mean, I want to talk about it at revival.
Amen.
And so, we have to tell the things that Jesus has done in our life too, right?
Amen.
Because
Amen.
It's going to get people excited. Amen. They're going to want, you know, what we've got. They're going to know the Lord. Invite people. Invite people to come to church, you know? And people that look like they might not want to come to church. I heard one man say that he said nobody had ever asked him, so he'd never been to church. Nobody had ever asked him. And then my aunt had a ministry. I've told this story before, but it's been a while. But she goes to church in Mayfield, and they had a ministry where they would go around and visit people, just different ones. And now this man wasn't a church member, but somebody gave him the name. And so they visited him, and he didn't really want anything to do with them. He never invited them in, I don't think. And so on this day, they were ready to mark him off the list because they felt like he was hopeless, right? Yeah. And so they went to his house. They thought they'd give it one more try. And he said, I've been waiting for y'all to come. And he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Y'all, that's all I'm really going to say today. I just, as we have our closing hymn this evening, I encourage you, the altar is a beautiful place to lay your burdens here. And if anything has come to your mind tonight when I'm saying that, if you're carrying any mistakes or any heartaches or anything you felt like you failed at, that is not from God. That is from Satan. And God is a forgiving God and great grace. And so we encourage you to come to the altar. And if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, oh, tonight is your night.
Amen.
And so
Amen.
We just encourage you to ask Jesus into your heart. Make sure he's there. Make sure.
Amen.
We will tell you, make sure.
Amen.
And my little sister and my mama, make sure that you have a connection. You have told Jesus that he is your Lord and Savior.
Amen.
Okay, Brother Nicky. Mm-hmm. Or
children. Pray for your family. out of the darkness into the light. By his marvelous grace. He loves you enough not to leave you where you were. But he saves you and loves you. Oh, he's so good to us. Praise him tonight.
Subside, if that's a good word. They said they think the medicine will help some. Maybe it will, I don't know. But I just place him in God's hands. That's where he needs to be, is in God's hands. He's a child of God.
Amen.
He knows where he's going.
Yes.
If it turns worse, he knows where he's going.
Amen.
And just would lift him up. I think good to see everyone here tonight. Miss Donna, wonderful message. Thank you. Thank you. We do need that grace. Amen. Amen. Let's pray, guys. Father, we thank you again for the wonderful day that you blessed us with. Lord, some people say, oh, it's too cold. Oh, the sun wasn't bright enough. Oh, it was cloudy. God, you designed this day. So, God, we're just going to give you praise for this day. And, Lord, you knew long before we ever woke up, you knew who was going to be here tonight.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know, Lord, that who is going to praise you. So, God, I just thank you for that. Thank you for being with not only family, but friends, with a church family. God, I thank you for that so much. Lord, I just ask and pray now that you continue to be with Miss Donna as she ministers to her church up in Illinois. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, be with Curtis Good as he continues to minister over in Mount Olive. Be with Brother Berman as, Lord, I know he's out there pushing them boys. Saying, drive it harder, boys. Drive it harder. Get that sheetrock done. Get that paint done. Get that car. I got to preach. Would you hurry up? That's what he's waiting on. So, Lord, be with them in their church and their building, God. And, Lord, be with Brother Mickey, dear Heavenly Father. I just love the man. And just as he leads this church, dear Heavenly Father, as he loves his church, dear Heavenly Father, God, we just ask and pray for a prayer for him tomorrow night.
Amen.
Give him the words, Lord. He thinks he's going to speak on blood, but God, you love to change his mind.
Yeah.
So God, just let him be open.
Yeah.
And let you speak through him, dear Heavenly Father. Lord, I don't want to leave out my brother Mike. Lord, as he continues to lead Prizeburg just up the road, God, Lord, be with him. Be with his family. Lord, be with his church. Lord, we lift him up to you. And God, it's just great to be here. This seven church family revival.
Yes.
Lord, what a thrill it is just to be in your house and give you praise. We thank you for all you've done and all you're going to do, dear Heavenly Father. And Lord, let us just come back tomorrow night excited.
Yes.
Let's repeat that. Let's get excited to come to the house of God tomorrow night. And let us bring someone with us. Let's fill this church tomorrow night. And give you praise, God, for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.